in the scripture lesson, it's a good change from what's in the bulletin, is John chapter 9, verses 1 through 11. As he passed by, he saw a man blind from his birth. And his disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "It was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be made manifest in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night comes when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." As he said this, he spat on the ground and made clay of his spittle and anointed the man's eyes with the clay, saying to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar said, "Is not this the man who used to sit and beg?" Some said, "It is he." Others said, "No, but he is like him." He said, "I am the man." They said to him, "Then how are your eyes open?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' So I went and washed and received my sight." The word of God, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. Gracious and holy God, my prayer each week, each day, each hour, is that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be ever acceptable unto you, my Lord and my Savior, my rock and my Redeemer, foundation of our lives and cornerstone of this church. It is in your holy name that we pray and say thank you and amen.
Amen.
There was a lady at my last church, and she used to leave the sanctuary every week and say, "Oh, thank you, Pastor Janice. Thank you for such an inspiring and positive message. There's never any condemnation." And I thought, well, you have a nice day then. have a nice week. And, you know, I can leave the service each week and wonder, never any condemnation. Never any condemnation. Is that really what we need? Is it what we want? Is it what God wants? Never any condemnation in preaching in the church morning, Sunday after Sunday? Anybody in trouble this morning? Anybody feeling a little uncomfortable, a little discomfort looming? Anybody remember a time of trouble? You've had some trouble before, right? So let me ask you this honest question. If you came to church this morning and you were really finding yourself in some real trouble, because I think you think trouble can be relative, right? My trouble might be a little different from your trouble. But if you came to church on Sunday morning and you were really in trouble, what would you need to hear? Would you want to hear condemnation from the pulpit, a little fire and brimstone? Would you like to hear about the God who punishes us when we're bad?
No.
No. Because instead, when we're in trouble, when we're really in trouble, we need to hear about the mercy of God, right? So that God's works can be revealed in the world. I think that's right. And so here's the thing. If you came to church and you're needing a little fire and brimstone, you might want to find it at the Baptist. No, I'm just kidding. But that's just not how I roll. Because I'm a person who actually,
absolutely believes that my experience is that we are consumed by fear anyway, right? We're consumed by all that the media wants to replay over and over and over again. We're beyond those terror, color-coded terror alerts, but we still have a fear of ISIS or Al-Qaeda, right? We still have a fear that our kids can't safely go to school because there are a lot of guns in the hands of a lot of people who shouldn't have guns, right? Then the media is going to replay the stories over and over and over again, and I think we've got enough fear in the world today. I think we've got enough fear and enough people out there who have had enough fire and brimstone or guilt and shame and the angry punishing God who only wants them to come to confession so they can receive sacrament or however that plays out. I think we've had enough of that, centuries really, and what we know about not only reteaching but unlearning so that we can be taught is it takes just as long to enforce what's good and undo what's damaged far too many people. I have talked to enough people out there who don't are afraid to even approach God, right? Afraid that you know, if Jesus only came to save us from these sins and that's all we are, that might not be the story that is saving us day by day by day. That doesn't sound or feel like new mercy every morning, amazing grace, how sweet the sound. That doesn't sound like no one sinned. I'm healing so that God's glory can be revealed to the world. That doesn't sound like that. My very first pastoral call with a cancer patient was an older woman. I think she was in her 70s at the time of our first visit. Her breast cancer had moved to her brain, and she was really, really struggling. And it was my first home visit. It was my first person who I was meeting who had cancer. And she welcomed me to her home, and we sat down at the table, and she made us a cup of tea. And the first question she asked me was, did I think she was being punched? And did I think that her disease was her punishment for something that she had done? And I said, no, I do not. It's not the understanding of the God who I have come to know, the God who saves us and does not destroy us, the God who gives life because we're Easter people, and the God who gives opportunities for new birth because we have a theology that is incarnational and within us and humanity, and that's why Jesus came. I didn't say that. That's what I meant. And then she proceeded to confess this sin, this one big sin, to me as if to ask me if I would change my mind, knowing that about her. And I simply said to her, no, my mind has not changed about that. I do not feel that God is punishing you for that. That's not the God I know. The God who says no one sinned. Now look, we can argue that there are passages, right, where it talks all about how we have sinned. So one might argue that no one sinned might suggest because we've all sinned, right? Therefore, we are not going to go there with this. This is not what this is about. This healing And so it is that I learned that the Christians in her neighborhood, the town gossip was that she was being punished for the sin. That the town gossip was that this is what God is doing to her because she had done that. That's the Christian narrative in the neighborhood. I don't know about you, but that's exactly the kind of thing that makes my blood boil. That is exactly the kind of thing that says, that's why the churches can't grow. That's why Sunday school is no longer the go-to must-enroll place for the kids. Because we're not representing out there the God that we have come to believe in over Elisha, who threw a lot of time. Now, it is true that God loves us just the way that we are. Troubled and in trouble, just the way that we are. But I kind of agree with something that I heard Rob Bell say, which was, of course, God loves us just the way we are. But God loves us too much to let us stay the way we are. So this healing work is about being transformed. Bodies, minds, and spirits, and maybe our theologies, so that we can get into an honest conversation out there with the neighbors about how we understand a God who saves us and didn't come to the world to condemn the world, but came to save the people, set them free, heal all that's broken, and promised them a life that is eternal, so we don't have to live this life consumed by fear of what might be ahead. And so it is true that we gather week in and week out, and we can come to know the Jesus who answered the Pharisees who wanted to know who sinned. Parents, the child, who said, what did they do? That's really what they do. You know that's the next question, right? Because that's who we are, human nature, right? We want to play the blame game. We want to decide whose fault it is rather than just fix the problem. We want to complain about what's wrong rather than be a part of the solution. The difference between deconstructing and helping things to fall apart and constructive work that helps to build us up, people up, the church up. No one sinned. The community couldn't hear Jesus say, stop it, chill out, settle down, it's not about that. I've come into the world to heal you. You and you and you and you. To fix what's broken in you and you and you and you. That church and that church. And everybody. And so, I don't know about you, but for me, that's a God I can stay in love with. That's a God who I can stay in love with. Not come to God so ashamed and then so broken down that I then have to be lifted up, but coming to God in fullness of who we are so that we can love God fully in who God is. And so my prayer for you this morning as we wonder about healing from the Lenten dust of the ground, Jesus makes a paste on the eye of the blind man, who people have walked by day by day by day, wondering what that guy did wrong, rather than wondering about this guy, Jesus, who healed, who broke the law to heal him, touch him, that God's glory and God's goodness might be made known. If you're in trouble this morning, my prayer is that you've heard that you are loved deeply by God in this church, by your sisters and brothers here. If you are not in trouble, but you know someone who is, this is an opportunity to introduce that person to a God who wants it all. Nobody knows the troubles we've seen. But God is good enough and great enough to heal it all.